गुड इवनिंग गाइस, प्लीज कंफर्म ऑडियो एंड वीडियो गाइस, या सो एवरीबॉडी कैन हियर मी एंड सी मी, प्लीज कंफर्म, या ओके वंडरफुल। सो गुड इवनिंग अगेन ऑल ऑफ यू, आई कैन सी सम फेमिलियर नेम्स, आई हैव मेट, आई हैव इंटरेक्टेड विद सम ऑफ यू ड्यूरिंग द एसे राइटिंग सेशन, बट सम ऑफ यू आर इंटरेक्टिंग विद मी फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम, सो हेलो टू एवरी वन। Today we'll be talking about the banking sector in India and some issues which are related to that. Fine. So that is our agenda for the day. This is how you will be progressing. Now, the definition of banking. Banking can be defined as the business activity of accepting and safeguarding money owned by other individuals and entities and then lending out this money in order to earn a profit. Okay. So essentially what this definition is saying that there are two. So in that case, if you're not able to hear me, you need to recheck your login. Yeah, you need to maybe exit the session and join again, because it doesn't seem to be a problem with the others. So if you can make it out, please exit, please join again, right? So anyways, as I was saying, this definition clearly outlines the two basic functions of a bank, right? So conceptually, a bank is supposed to do two major things. The first is to accept deposits, right? So it has to borrow money from various sources in the form of deposits, and a bank is then supposed to lend that money to other people who want money, and it earns a difference of what is called as a spread, right? So suppose a bank borrows money from you in the shape of an FD at 8%, it will lend the same money to a company or to somebody who needs a home loan, and the rate of interest will be 10%. So it borrows at 8%, it lends at 10%, right? So borrowing rate 8%, let me just make the color a little more visible. So the bank will borrow at 8%, it will lend the money to you at 10%. The difference in between these two broadly, roughly, is called as spread, right? So this is a bank's source of income. This is the major source of income for a bank. It is called a spread. Okay. Now, there are other sources of income as well for a bank. I'll come back to that a little later. But this is what the definition is broadly saying. The definition is saying that the bank will borrow money from depositors and it will lend money to people who want to borrow money for various needs. So people borrow money for home loans, for personal loans, for the purpose of education. People borrow for corporate loans, companies borrow money. So for various reasons, people borrow money, and banks borrow from individual investors, borrow from the RBI, right? Borrow from corporates, and then they further lend it out to those people who need money. The two core functions of a bank is borrowing and lending, earning the margin in between. Okay, so that is how a bank functions. So this is a pictorial representation of what I was telling you. So bank will take deposits from individual savers as well as from companies, right? And then it will lend that money to people who need the money, right? So these could be again individuals, could be corporates as well, right? These corporates, these borrowers will pay interest to the bank. And of course, they will repay the loan after the due date is there. And then the banks will also pay you interest on the money that you have put in that FD, in that fixed deposit. So then this is how a bank functions. Guys, please feel free to stop me wherever you feel that there is a doubt or any issue. Please feel free to put your question in the chat box, right? So the primary functions and secondary functions, I told you there are other sources of a bank's income. Obviously, a bank has to do some other work and therefore it will earn some other income, but this is what we mean by the primary and secondary functions. So the primary functions, as we discussed, are accepting deposits and granting loans. How does a bank accept deposits? So look back at your own experience. I'm sure all of you have a saving account in a bank. You may have also put fixed deposits with the bank. There is another instrument called a recurring deposit. Again, both individuals and corporates can use this. And corporates have something called a current account or a current deposit account. Can anybody tell me the difference between a savings account and a current account? Overdraft. Okay, that is one of the characteristics, Anuj, but it is not the main difference. No interest is also a characteristic. Hitesh, what do you mean it is temp? What do you mean by that? No, duration is not a difference. No, Hitesh, that is not the difference. Current account is zero balance. It does not pay interest is true, but these are characteristics. This is not the main difference. Akshay, the number of transactions being different is also a characteristic. What's the major difference, guys? Abhimanyu, absolutely correct. Yeah. The difference is who gets to open a savings account versus who gets to open a current account. So non-individual entities are allowed by RBI to open current accounts. Individuals will open savings accounts. Then you have the characteristics. Saving accounts have to be characterized by an interest rate. So whatever deposit that you put in a saving account earns interest. There is generally, for most banks, a minimum balance requirement for savings account. Generally, the number of transactions in a saving account is limited. Current account is a zero balance account. The corporate does not need to maintain any balance. Current account also does not pay any interest if there is a balance. Also, the current account holder has a larger flexibility in terms of the number of transactions which are allowed. Right, so these are characteristics. There are characteristics in terms of overdraft facilities, checkbooks, demand draft facilities, which are different from a saving account and a current account. But the principal difference is that the saving account is meant for individuals and the current account is meant for non-individuals. So corporates, HUFs, organizations will all open current accounts. Okay. On the other side of the picture, in terms of loans, there are many types of loans and advances. So again, this can be characterized, even if though it is not on the screen for you, I'll just put it up. So loans and advances could be to individuals, could be to corporates. Okay. And corporates, you have cash credit limits, overdraft limits, you have loans, term loans, you have bill discounting. For individuals, you have personal loans, you have housing loans, you have other instruments like overdrafts. Overdrafts are for both, right? You also have education loans, right? So there are different terminologies used for the borrowings which are done by individuals and done by corporates. But a bank can lend to both. A bank can give personal loans, housing loans, overdraft facilities, and education loans. Even for that matter, even a credit card. So even credit cards are a type of a loan. I'll come back to overdraft and bill discounting. BD stands for bill discounting. Okay, so personal loans, housing loans, overdrafts, education loans and credit cards are all individual borrowings when individuals borrow. And corporates can borrow in the form of cash credit limits, in the form of overdraft facilities, in the form of term loans and in the form of discounting of bills. Okay, so overdraft, the garage is basically overdrawing the balance of your account. Okay, in simple terms, if your account has 1 lakh rupees, the bank may at its discretion allow you to withdraw 1,50,000, right? So your balance is 1 lakh in the account. You can withdraw more than the balance in your account. In the simplest way, that is what an overdraft facility is, or an ability to overdraw. Okay, so withdraw over the balance in your account. Why would a bank do that, you may ask? A bank will obviously not do that just like that. It will do that against some security, right? So it will allow you to withdraw more money than is there in account when they have some security or collateral, right? Then they will allow you to, like I said, Digraj, there is a collateral generally which is required. For example, a lot of individual borrowers get an overdraft facility when they keep a fixed deposit, right? So for example, what I can do, I can keep a fixed deposit with a bank at 8% per annum, right? That's the interest rate. After a month, I require some money. I only have the fixed deposit, right? Now I have a choice. I can break the fixed deposit and use the amount. However, there is a constraint. The bank will charge me a penalty. So generally, I hope you know that when we break fixed deposits, bank charge a premature withdrawal penalty. So I don't want to do that. I don't want to lose money. So what I will ask the bank? I will ask the bank to give me an overdraft facility against the collateral security of the fixed deposit. So I can do that. My FD remains there in the bank. It keeps on earning interest. And whatever money I overdraw, I give interest to the bank. Right, so that can be done. Okay, so coming back to bill discounting, anybody? Mangesh wants to know what is bill discounting. Any idea, guys? What is a bill discounting? Okay, chalo, I'll explain. So it's a corporate tool. Essentially, what is happening is, let us say there are two corporates, corporate A and corporate B. Okay, so two companies, A and B. So company A is selling products to company B. So let us say this guy is selling iron ore. This guy makes iron ore. And this guy is a steel manufacturer. Or whatever. You can choose your own example here. So this guy manufactures iron ore. Iron ore is a raw material for company B. Okay. So this guy sells. Yes, Abhimanyu. Okay. So Tanika, yes. Something like this. Let me explain in detail. Company A sells iron ore worth, let us say, 1 lakh to company B, and company B says, fine, I'll pay you, but I need some time, right? So I need some time, I'm a little tight on cash, I'll pay you after 1 month. Okay, so company A can go to a bank and company A can say, please take this bill, Mr. Banker, and give me my amount today. So we are talking about day one. The amount is to be received from company B after 30 days. So on day one, company A will go to the bank and say, give me my money today against the security of this bill. Okay. So the bank will give company A the money. Of course, they will cut their own charges. They will deduct their own charges. After 30 days, this bank will go to company B and claim the payment, right? So this is bill discounting. I think you should have a fair idea, a rough idea of what bill discounting is, guys. Yeah, okay, great. So then in that case, let's move on. Okay, once again, Vishwanath, okay, I'll do that, guys. It's pretty simple. What it means is that, okay, let me just use a fresh worksheet then. So again, let us say there is a company A, which is selling its products. Let us say this guy makes tires and he is selling these tires to company B. Company B is Maruti. So this guy is Apollo tires, fine. So company A makes tires and sells them to company B. And there is a bill of 1 lakh when he sells the tires. There is a bill of 1 lakh which you go and say, Mr. B, these tires are worth 1 lakh rupee. Please give me my payment. Company B says, I will give you your payment after 1 month. So the company B asks for a time of 1 month. Right? Company A on day one itself needs the money. So they go to a bank. Let's say the bank is SBI, State Bank of India. And they say to State Bank of India, this is a bill for which company B will make a payment after 1 month. Please give me my money today. Now, the bank will pay company A, let us say 90,000. Why 90,000? Because the rest is the fee or commission of the bank. This is what the bank earns, right? After 1 month, what will happen? So company A is out of the picture. On day one, they sent the tires and they got their money from the bank. Out, finished, done. Now after 1 month, the bank will go to Maruti with the bill in hand and claim the payment of 1 lakh rupees. So bank paid 90,000 and got back 1 lakh after 1 month. Okay. Now again, the question in your mind could be, why would the bank do this? Because after 1 month, company B may refuse to make the payment. There is a risk. Obviously, the bank is not going to take any risks. The bank will obviously take some sort of security from company A for doing this transaction. So there is always, when a bank gives a loan, there is some nature of collateral involved. Some nature of collateral, some nature of security involved. Okay, Divya, nobody will lose. Essentially, if you want to go a little deeper into the transaction, Divya, yes, collateral security proof. Yeah, so let me explain Divya's question first. So Divya, when these guys decided to get into a supply arrangement, they would have discussed the terms of payment, right? So company A and B would have discussed the terms of payment right before this guy started manufacturing tires, right? So company A would have discussed the price and the payment terms with company B when they struck the deal. So therefore, when B said, you supply me tires, but I will pay you after 1 month, company A would have incorporated that in their price. So therefore, the tires of the bill value of 1 lakh rupees would include the cost which company A knows I will have to pay to the bank. Okay, so that is how the transaction works. So nobody loses in this transaction. Bhavya, bank ka profit 10,000 exactly nahi hai, because there is a time value of money also. There is a 1 month time period cost of that money also. Right, so it is not exactly 10,000. There are other expenses also which the bank has to take into account. There is a risk value also. So the bank will make a profit, but it will not be the complete thing. Okay. Sudhakar, it could be any bank here, any bank which company A approaches. How will the bank decide whether to do this transaction? The bank will look at what collateral security company A is offering. What is the relationship length? So suppose company A has been a customer of the bank for the last 10 years, that adds to the comfort. If the company A is approaching this bank for the first time, the bank will do more diligence. The bank will be more careful. So it will look at the length of association. It will look at the collateral security being offered. It will also look at the goodwill of this customer. So if this customer, company B, is a small company, the risk is more. If this company B is a big company like Maruti, the risk is obviously going to be less, right? Because Maruti knows that if they default, their brand value will also take a hit. So a big company, when that is the customer, the bank will look at that factor also. So there are many factors a bank looks at while doing this transaction. So Dakar, I hope that explains the point. Chalo, let's go back then. Yeah, so these are the primary functions of a bank. The secondary functions of a bank could be any of these. So there are two types of secondary functions. One is where the bank acts as an agent, and the second is a utility function, when the bank does a service. Okay, so agency functions could be fund transfer, could be check payments and collections, could be periodic payment or collection, could be portfolio management, could be anything else. Similarly, utility functions could be when they give you a locker, could be underwriting of shares, could be issuing of drafts, letters of credit, dealing in foreign exchange, project reports, social welfare programs, any of these, right? So these are the functions which a bank performs. Like I told you, there are other sources of income. For each of these functions, for all of these, as well as these, the bank will earn a fee or a commission. So guys, what you know now is that for a bank, there is only two sources of income, right? So when you look at financial reports, when you look at financial news channels, you will see that when the bank's results come, so in January now, or sometime in the second half of January, you will find the all the banks in India start declaring their Q3 results, quarter three results from October to December. At that time, please understand, please notice that there are two types of income that they are talking about. One is called net interest income, or NII. Okay, this is nothing but the spread that we discussed. This is the difference between what I charge on loans which I give versus the deposit interest rate. So I take deposits from people, I pay interest on that, I charge interest on loans. So this is the major source of income for a bank. This is the primary functions that we were talking about. And the other source of income for a bank is fee and commission on these services. Okay. Divya, I'll explain underwriting and portfolio management. Tanika, where in between? Yeah, I wrote fee and commission. Right? Okay, good. Okay, so underwriting of shares. See, essentially, I will not go very deep into this. This itself is a very broad topic. Underwriting of shares broadly means that when a company wants to sell its shares to the common public, that is, they want to have an IPO. Some of you might be aware of the term IPO, initial public offer. Some banks undertake underwriting of shares. Essentially, what it means is they tell the company that you are offering 1 crore shares to the public for public to take up and buy your shares. If people don't buy your shares, we will. So bank can give that service. Again, they will charge a fee for this. So the bank will say, Mr. Airtel, Mr. Bharti, you are offering 1 crore shares to the public for getting capital. You are offering it in an IPO. If people don't subscribe your IPO, I will. Right? So the bank, again, why will the bank do this? One, the bank will earn fee and commission on this. Secondly, the bank will look at the company, the financial performance, the growth outlook, and they will decide that if worst comes to worst, we would like to have capital ownership in this company. Right? Worst comes to worst, if nobody subscribes, we will pick up ownership. So that facility, that service is called underwriting of shares. Yeah, portfolio management. Divya, it could be any price. Yeah, it could be at a price mutually understood between the two parties, right? Portfolio management is basically a function where the bank advises, this is essentially for rich clients, bank advises clients on how best to invest their money, right? So there are many ways to invest money. So let's say I have 1 lakh rupees and the bank will now come to me and say, you could put it in the share market. You could buy Government of India bonds. You could buy the government products like Public Provident Fund or Kisan Vikas Patras or Post Office Savings deposits. So the bank will tell me that there are various options. You could invest in gold, right? So they will tell me various instruments, and depending on my age, depending on my occupation, depending on how much risk I want to take, depending on the money which I have, depending on my needs, they will advise me on how to best invest my money. This service is called portfolio management. Right? Mutual funds is just one of the ways you can invest your money. It's just one option. Tanika, yes. Okay. Just to give you a little bit of an idea, for rich clients, you have companies called investment banks and hedge funds, where they can even do cross-border investments abroad. So I will not go into, I'm sure some of you would have heard the term investment banks and hedge funds. They can do these kind of investments abroad also, right? So again, this is just a little bit of information for you. Underwriting of shares, Tanika, is when any company wants to do an IPO. For example, just a couple of months back, Cafe Coffee Day came out with their IPO. They came to the stock market with their shares, and they asked the general public to invest in their company. So at that time, Cafe Coffee Day would have approached many banks. So maybe they approached Citibank, ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, and asked them to underwrite the IPO. What it means is that in case the people don't pick up the shares, don't buy the shares, these banks undertake that they will buy the shares, right? So they do that for a fee. Right. So this is the secondary functions, guys. So a bank has two sources of income: net interest income from the spread, and the second is fees and commission on various services which banks give. Right. Different types of banks exist in India. Of course, you have the central bank, which is the Reserve Bank of India. You have commercial banks, so the banks that you see every day in your life. So your your banks like State Bank of India, banks like ICICI Bank, HDFC, Citibank, HSBC are all commercial banks. This is actually even a short form. The full name is Scheduled Commercial Banks, or SCBs. You have local area banks, which are regional in nature. You have cooperative banks, and then you have developmental banks. Developmental banks, for example, companies like IDFC for infrastructure and industrial development, right? ICICI, before it converted to a regular bank, it was a developmental bank. Even HDFC is a developmental bank. HDFC, not HDFC Bank, right? Yeah, HDFC is still the housing finance company, still a developmental nature. It is a infrastructure development company, right? So even SIDBI or even Exim Bank, for example, these are developmental banks. Exim Bank is export import bank. Developmental banks are for the particular purpose, right? So for example, NABARD is a developmental bank for the purpose of agricultural development. So its entire focus, it can do all the banking functions, but it is focused on the field of agriculture and agriculture related activities, right? So developmental banks are focused on the developmental area for which they have been envisioned, right? Commercial banks can borrow and lend to any sector of the Indian economy, right? Cooperative banks, I'll come to. So you would have seen cooperative banks also. So there is Chandigarh Cooperative Bank, there is Punjab State Cooperative Bank. Every state has its own cooperative banks. Yeah, so there are many. Yeah, Nainital would also have its own cooperative bank. Exim Bank is developmental anush because it is specifically meant for the purpose of export and import trade. Right, so facilitate export and import trade transactions, Exim Bank was created. So Pushp, it is not necessarily for developmental banks to see, the purpose of developmental banks is laid down by the government, because developmental banks are incorporated by the government of India, right? So these are public sector undertakings, and they cannot by themselves decide that, okay, I'm going to become a commercial banks. These are generally done by statutes of law, right? So it is therefore they have been designed for the development of a particular sector. That is how they function. It can, but if the government so decides, right? So it is the prerogative of the government. It is not the bank itself to decide, right? I'll come back to cooperative banks again, guys. Let me first come to them one by one. So the RBI established 1935 RBI Act. It's an act, it's a law. 1934, head office at Mumbai. Function of the RBI, majorly it's the monetary authority. So if you want to look at it in a sentence, in a definition kind of a format, the RBI's role is to make policy, monetary policies, also regulate and implement those policies. So whatever regulation implementation has to be done by RBI. It has also got punitive powers. In case it founds that there is some problem or some bank is violating some norms, it also can do punish. So it has punitive powers also. So basically it makes the laws, it implements the laws, and is also going to be the court in case any monetary issues take place. Any bank violates any monetary policy, right? So that is the role of the RBI. So it also regulates and supervises the financial system. It manages India's foreign exchange reserves and currency. It also prints currency, right? And of course, the monetary organizations or monetary institutions in India are also developed by RBI. For example, we'll come back to this later, but for example, recently a new set of monetary financial organizations called payment banks have come into existence. This is an initiative of the Reserve Bank of India, right? So monetary institution building is also a role of the RBI. Okay, so let's talk about the monetary policy first, because this is the most important from the point of view of your selection processes. Monetary policy deals with the RBI's guidelines on how money supply will be controlled in the economy. So the RBI has various instruments to control money in the economy. Traditionally, we all have heard about CRR and SLR, right? So we've all heard, I believe, about CRR and SLR. Some other tools that some of you may have heard of are repo rate, reverse repo rate, and bank rate, okay? However, we will look at these and many more tools now, right? So we will talk about tools like base rate. We will talk about tools like marginal standing facility, liquidity adjustment facilities, right? So we will talk about all of these now. These are all money controlling tools, right? So any idea, guys? Let's start with CRR. What is, yeah, open market operations, absolutely. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about selective credit control, SCC also. So any idea, guys? Let's start with CRR. Explain to me, what is CRR? Yeah, so 4% it is, but what is CRR? How much a bank needs to keep in RBI as a reserve? Okay, what is the purpose of this reserve? What is the purpose, guys, of this? No, this is not to facilitate withdrawal. Security, okay. Money flow, manage risk, save default. Absolutely, guys. So this is to manage this sector risk. So for example, if we have a situation like Greece, right, which means the whole banking sector is in under threat of going under the water, right? So the whole sector is threatened. The whole financial situation of the country becomes unstable. For that, the RBI keeps certain reserve, 4% as reserve, as cash reserve ratio. All banks have to keep 4% of their deposits with the RBI as CRR. Okay, this is a mandate. No bank can avoid this. This is to ensure sector stability. This is for the entire financial sector, right? I didn't understand your question, Tanika. Does change in recent time? What do you mean? So if you're talking about the rate has not changed recently. Actually, yeah. So current rate of CRR hasn't been changed recently. Actually, there has been a big controversy on CRR recently because a few people in the banking industry and even within the RBI feel that the CRR is a redundant tool. Essentially, since, like I said, it hasn't been changed in a really long time, it hasn't been really used as a money control tool. That is the first objection. And the second is, the RBI doesn't give interest to banks on this money, right? So I keep 4% of my deposit. So I get 100 rupees from the public. I'm a bank. I give 4 rupees to RBI to keep. And the RBI gives me nothing on this. So that is the other objections which bank have, that either you give us interest or you let us use it, right? So therefore, the banks have this objection. Many within the RBI also feel that the CRR is now a redundant tool of monetary policy. And there have been voices to eliminate the whole concept of CRR per se. But so far, the RBI is sticking with CRR as it is. Okay. So that is CRR for you. Yeah. The second is SLR. Okay, so guys, can you tell me what is SLR and what's the difference between CRR and SLR? No, Tanika, it is not a redundant policy. That is some of the criticism which has come, right? So people are saying that as a monetary policy, it hasn't really been used for a very long time. People are saying that if you wanted to use it, you should have changed the rate up and down as per the requirements, but you haven't really done it. So one, that is the objection. Second is that since RBI doesn't pay any interest on this, again, banks are crying. Okay, so it is not redundant. People are saying, certain quarters are saying that it is really a redundant tool. Okay, bonds, government securities, or even gold. Wonderful. Cash kept with the band itself. Okay, absolutely. So as you guys have rightly said, the statutory liquidity ratio is an amount which the banks have to maintain with themselves, okay, for the purpose of meeting daily withdrawal requirements. So you give 100 rupees to a bank, wonderful, but then in the evening you want to go to the ATM and withdraw some money. So the bank needs to have certain money with itself for the purpose of withdrawals, for the purpose of daily liquidity requirements. That is the purpose of SLR. Okay, so SLR can be maintained in cash or cash equivalents. Cash equivalents, for example, government approved securities, bonds, treasury bills, it could be gold as well, right? So this is how SLR can be maintained, right? So that is how these two are different. CRR is to be maintained with RBI for sector stability, whereas SLR is for daily financial liquidity to meet the requirement of withdrawals, okay? That is the two basic tools that we all know of, right? What is the SLR rate right now, guys? Current SLR rate? Yeah, it is for meeting daily liquidity requirements, Amit. Current SLR rate? 21? No. Vishan, 21.5. Okay, 23. We are getting warmer and warmer, yeah. Guys, 5? 22.5. तनिका हाउ इज इट फाइव यार, फाइव तो क्या 24, 21.5 करंट एस एल आर इज 23 गाइस, 23%. अतुल इट इज फॉर डेली रिक्वायरमेंट्स इन द सेंस दैट every day we go to ATMs and withdraw money, people withdraw cash, so for that the bank needs to maintain certain cash with itself. That is how SLR is supposed to be designed, for meeting daily liquidity requirements, right? Okay, chalo, so that is the SLR. The third is base rate. A relatively recent, last 3-4 years we have started hearing this term called base rate. What is a base rate, guys? Now we get to the tougher terms. What is a base rate? Okay, and Hitesh, is this different for every bank? Is it the same for all banks? RBI decides base rate? Okay, guys, like I said, these are the ones which are a little tougher, the ones which you probably don't know about. It is, base rate is the minimum lending rate for each bank. So each bank is free to have its own different base rate. It is not decided by RBI. Each bank, looking at its cost of funds, will decide its base rate, right? For example, let me just share with you, right? So let us say bank A, guys, have a look at this example so then you'll understand. So bank A gets 100 rupees in its saving account on which it pays 4%, gets 100 rupees in FDs on which it pays 8%, and gets 100 rupees in a current account on which it pays 0. So this is my deposits. I've got 300 rupees. What is my cost of 300 rupees? Can somebody tell me? For these 300 rupees, what is my annual cost? Cost, guys. So that is the interest payment. Come on, guys. Yeah, it's 12 rupees. Yeah. So 12 rupees. So my cost for the full year on these three deposits is 12 rupees. Bank B. So which means on 300 rupees, my cost comes to, if I look at it in percentage, my cost comes to 4%, right? That's my cost of funds. Bank B gets 100 rupees in a saving account. I pay 4% on that. I get 50 rupees in an FD, right? So I get 50 rupees in FD. I pay 8% on that. And I get 150 rupees in a current account. What's the cost of Bank B? Annual cost, correct, so 8 rupees. Now as my deposits are 300, this comes to approximately 2.66% cost. The cost of funds for both banks are different. Therefore, the base rate, the minimum rate at which they lend will also be different. This guy can probably lend at something like 4 to 5%. This guy can only lend at, let us say, 7 to 8%. Minimum. So therefore, every bank, depending on the nature of their deposits, somebody will have more current account balance, somebody will have more FDs, somebody will have more current saving account deposits. So depending on the nature of each bank's cost, their base rate will be different. Is this clear now, guys? So therefore, the first message I want to give you is base rate is the minimum rate at which banks lend. It is a lending term, right? So this is a lending term, and for each bank, it will be different. It will depend on each bank's cost of funds. Okay. The base rate was earlier preceded by another term called the PLR. Okay, there used to be a term in banking. It's no longer there now. It used to be a rate called PLR. Used to be the prime lending rate. Okay, now bank shifted from PLR to base rate 4-5 years back. RBI does not have any base rates. Just to continue and complete the discussion on base rate, just a week back, okay, RBI has instructed banks to shift from this base rate method of lending to another method of lending, which is called the MCLR. MCLR, okay. I'll come back to PLR, Amit. So the current recommendation, which will come into force from 1st April 2016. Guys, this is important. This is a very recent development. From 1st April 2016, banks will calculate their lending rate based on MCLR. What is this MCLR? Marginal cost based lending rate. Marginal cost based lending rate. Okay. Just to make it simple for you. So when I, let's say I'm a bank, I give a home loan to you, right? And it's a home loan of 20 lakh rupees for 20 years. My base rate is 10%. I lend my money 20 lakh rupees to you for 20 years time at a rate of 10%, right? Now, the interest rates in the economy are declining. RBI in the last 1 year has decreased the repo rate two or three times. So interest rates are declining. But banks have not been able to pass on that benefit because banks have many sources of funds. Bank get their funds from many sources, from individual borrowers, from corporate people who give FDs to bank, right? From current account, from saving accounts. So banks have not been able to decrease their base rate. So what RBI has said now, that whatever loans that you give, please give it at the marginal cost of your funds. Marginal cost is that whenever interest rates are falling, banks' additional borrowing cost will come down. Whenever banks borrow from RBI at the new repo rate, right, it will be a lower cost of borrowing. Therefore, banks will have to also lend at a lower rate. The idea behind doing this is that the benefit of lower rate should get passed on to customers. Okay, I'm sure you have not completely understood this, but you should understand the part that the RBI has said that the bank should also shift now from base rate phenomena. They should move on to an MCLR based lending. So marginal cost lending rate. Anuj, if you've got a partial idea, that's really good. Yeah, this is not easy to get a hang of. Yes, Shubham, effectively base rate. So base rate structure will stay. So bank will say that I will give you 10% as a base rate. But the bank also has an option for short-term loans to reduce your interest rates beyond base rate, because their marginal cost may be lower, and therefore the marginal cost of loans which they give further may also go down, right? So simply put, that is what the banks can do now. This will come into effect from 1st of April this year. Yeah, so Shubham, RBI wants the benefit to be passed on to customers, absolutely, right? Of course, Madhav, that is going to happen. But like I said, see, for example, you have placed an FD with a bank for 5 years. Theek hai, Madhav? Aapne 5 years FD rakha and you placed it at 8%. Now, RBI cuts repo rates. Fine. Repo rate, unhone cut karke from, let us say, 7.25, they've made it 6.75. So, 0.5%, they've reduced the repo rate. So, bank bolta hai, so ICICI bank will say, arre, but maine FD to already 8% pe liya hua hai. My funds which are currently with me are going to cost me 8%. How can I reduce the cost of my loans? Right? So RBI is saying, okay, fine. For that portion, that's fine. For the longer term loans that you got, fine. But for further loans, right? Jo aap aur borrowing karenge, wo kam rate pe karenge. And therefore, you can lend newer loans and short term loans at a marginal rate. So marginal basically means the cost of my new borrowings is lower. Therefore, the cost of my new loans will also be lower. Okay. Okay, so this is what the latest is on the base rate issue. Then you have the bank rate. Actually, I should have explained this before base rate, but anyways, the bank rate is the rate at which RBI lends money to banks. So like I told you earlier, banks get deposits, get their money from many sources. One is you and me. We put our deposits in banks in the form of FDs, saving accounts, recurring deposits. Then banks also get money from corporates in the form of current account balances and FDs. Banks can also borrow from RBI, right? So RBI, when it lends to banks, it is going to lend at a rate called the bank rate. The repo rate is also similar, right? So Amit, yes, that's the point I was coming to next. Repo rate is also similar. Repo rate is also a rate at which RBI will lend money to banks. However, there are two key differences. The first is repo rate is a short-term rate, generally not more than 15 days. Okay, so banks get short-term money from RBI at repo rate. Longer term, generally 1 year and more, banks can borrow from RBI at bank rate. That is the first difference. The second is bank rate is without collateral. RBI gives loans to banks at bank rate without any collateral security, whereas short term repo rate is generally done with a collateral security. Collateral securities are the same. It could be gold, it could be Government of India securities, it could be bonds and bills. Yeah, so Divya, that's what I'm saying. Generally, it's a short term. It could even be 6 months. So that below 1 year, repo rate will apply. So generally, PUSP, like I said, bank rate is without collateral. Logic will tell you bank rate is going to be higher, right? Because it is a loan without a security, right? So repo rate currently is about 6.75%, if I'm not wrong, and the bank rate is 7.75%. Right, so it is a rate for transactions. So base rate, like I said, was a rate for transaction between a bank and a borrower, somebody who is going to get a loan. A bank rate and a repo rate are terms that we use between transaction between bank and RBI. These are terms we use there. Divya, you can check it out on the internet. I think it's 7.75, but again, that hardly matters. You can check that out to be sure. Okay. So bank rate and repo rate are similar. In fact, there are other terms also used when RBI lends money to banks. Okay, I'll come back to that. Then we have the concept of reverse repo rate. Let me come to that first. Reverse repo rate is the opposite of repo rates. When banks have excess money, more than the SLR and CRR requirement, they can park the idle cash with RBI and get interest on that. That rate is called the reverse repo rate. It is the rate at which banks lend money to RBI. Okay, as a rule, repo rate minus 1% is reverse repo rate. So if RBI wants to lend to a bank, it will charge 6.75. if banks want to lend to RBI, they will get 5.75, right? So that is how reverse repo and repo work. Okay, so what can RBI do? So like I said, these are all tools of monetary policy for controlling money flow. If the RBI wants to release more money into the economy, if it sees that the inflation is low, if it sees that the fiscal deficit and current account deficit are in control, if it sees that the economy needs a jump start, it needs a growth kick, it will decrease interest rates, right? Because people get cheaper money. If the RBI sees that inflation is too high, if the RBI sees that the current account deficit is going out of control, RBI will increase interest rates to squeeze money out of the economy. Right? Amit, it is rarely used. See, essentially, look at the situation, it will happen. So let us say I've got 4%, I've got 100 rupees deposits. Let's say I'm ICICI Bank, I got 100 rupees deposits from people. I put 4 in CRR, I put 23 in SLR. So I'm left with 73 rupees. Now I will have idle money when I am not able to lend the 73 rupees. So when I go to the market and I'm offering personal loans, credit cards, home loans, right, all sorts of loans, and there is no taker, I am not able to give 73 rupees loan to people, then I will park that idle money with RBI, right? It happens very rarely. Most of the times it doesn't happen. Okay. Digraj, I didn't understand your question. Yeah, could you rephrase that? Basis point and relation between repo rate. I didn't understand that. Please tell me again, what do you want to know? Yeah, RBI reduced 50 basis. Okay, you asked me what is basis point. Okay, basis point, Digraj, is stands for 0.01%, right? So 0.01% is called 1 basis point. So when it says 50 basis point, it means 0.5%. Okay, so if the RBI, like I said, RBI reduced the repo rate from 7.25 to 6.75, that means it has reduced the rate by 0.5%, or you can also call it 50 basis points. Yeah, okay. So that is the repo and reverse repo. But there are other tools also of monetary policy. Let me come to open market operations. Open market operations is simple, guys. This is not done between any single bank and the RBI. So the RBI calls all the banks and says, I am going to buy or sell Government of India securities. right? So the government of India securities can be bought and sold in an open market operation. If the RBI wants to suck liquidity from the banks, it wants to tighten interest rates, or it wants to have less cash in the economy, right? What can I do? I can give government of India bonds, I can sell government of India bonds to the banks. Banks will get the bonds, they will pay the RBI money. Money will automatically move out of the economy. If the RBI wants to release money into the economy, I will have an open market operation. It is like a market. RBI bolta hai, aao sare bank wale aa jao, main bond bech raha hu, government of India bonds bech raha hu, khareed lo. So money will be sucked out. RBI can also go and says, mere ko becho, sell your government of India bonds to me. I am buying. So the RBI will buy bonds, give the money to banks, liquidity will increase. Essentially, in this, government of India bonds are bought or sold, interest rates are not touched. But you are still controlling money supply, right? So that is what happens in OMO. English. Okay, let me just read your questions, guys. Divya, it's not about profit, yeah. It's about whether the banks, what. So again, if they have excess cash, they can invest. So like I said, what can you do? You can go to RBI and place money with RBI at, suppose, let's say I have that 73 rupees, 100 rupees deposit aya, 4 rupees CRR, 23 SLR, I have 73. I gave loans of 65. I still have 8 rupees balance with me. What can I do with the 8 rupees? I can go to RBI and place it at reverse repo rate at that 5.75%. Or if RBI is selling Government of India bonds which carry a coupon rate of 8%, don't you think I want to spend my 8 rupees there? I'll invest my 8 rupees there. Instead of getting 5.75, I'll buy that bond at 8%. Right? So then the banks will buy the bonds. Otherwise, if the RBI is saying that, okay, I'll sell the bonds. Okay? Or rather, the RBI is saying, I will buy the bonds. If for example, I have more Government of India bonds than the SLR requirement. So SLR cut the government of, RBI has cut the SLR. So 23, it used to be 24 and a half sometime back, a year back. So RBI cuts SLR. I have more bonds than which I require now. I can sell the bonds to RBI and use the cash to give loans. Right? So in both cases, I can do that. Okay. So guys, whatever you didn't understand, please ask me. Amit and whoever else. Yeah. Digraj, I'll come to the US bond rates once I'm able to cover India. Yeah. If you'll just hold on for maybe another half an hour, if we get time today. Yes, I can. It is maintained every day. It is on daily balances. SLR is a percentage to be maintained on daily deposit balances. Government bonds are, for example, the government can issue bonds, or the government's various departments can issue bonds to the general public or through RBI, saying that this is the money which the government of India wants to raise, right? So for various purposes, for example, the rural electrification bonds were recently there. So a couple of months back, you had the rural electrification bonds. So the government of India wants to build electricity infrastructure in villages. For that, it is raising money from the general public, borrowing money, and it is issuing bonds. So those kind of bonds, so it could be infrastructure bonds, could be healthcare bonds, could be anything. So like I said, infrastructure, healthcare, electrification, energy, all of these. Yeah, it could be even be road transport, building roads, dams, highways, all those things. Harsh, yaar, see, flow of money will affect inflation in a very simple way. Any price of anything in the world, whether it is an IPL match tickets, whether it is a movie ticket, or whether it is the price of bhindi and dal, right? Inflation is that only, the price of things going up or down. So the price of anything in the world will be determined by only two factors, always, every time, which is demand and supply. So when RBI releases more money into the economy, right, there is more money in people's pockets, cheaper money is available. What does that mean? Demand for products and services will go up. So you will be able to buy more dal. Right? And therefore the price of dal will go up. So when demand is more than supply, price will go up. That is why IPL tickets are sold in black. Right? Because the demand is more than supply. On the other side, whenever supply increases and demand is less than supply. For example, today we were talking about an example earlier on the steel industry. So world steel supply is much, much more. There is a glut of steel supply in the world. The demand is not there. China is in recession. Europe is not doing well. US is not doing well. So the demand is not there. Supply is more. Steel prices have crashed. So price will always be determined by demand and supply. Yes, so Tanika ne kya keh diya? Acha, Tanika, I'm just answering questions, yeah. There's nothing else. We're talking about open market operations and I'm just talking about questions after that. Yes, guys, can you just again put up whatever questions are left? Okay, Amit. Government bonds are bought by, like I said, there are two cases when a bank will buy government bonds. One, the bank has excess cash. I am not able to lend it. So rather than parking it in reverse repo, which has a low interest rate, I'd rather park it in a Government of India bond, which has a higher interest rate. So that's one way I would buy, a bank would buy a Government of India bond. The second is when the RBI increases SLR. So RBI, today SLR is 23, RBI says SLR from tomorrow is 24. Now I'll have to buy more government bonds. So then these are the two reasons I will buy bonds. Private players, private companies issue bonds, but they call it by a different name, Digraj. Those are called debentures. Some of you would have heard of a term called debentures. It's just a terminology. That's the only difference. Bonds are as risky as any government instrument. For example, you go to a post office and you open a savings account. So if the government collapses or if the government finances collapse like in Greece, then that risk is there. But I'm sure you'll agree it's a very nominal risk. It's a very small risk. It will depend if the whole economy collapses and the government finances go haywire. That's the only risk. Anuj, I was saying, Digraj asked me about whether private companies can issue bonds. I said companies can issue bonds, but they are not called bonds, they are called debentures. So when a company wants to raise money from the public, it can do it in the form of debentures, private company. There are other functional differences, but in terms of definition, this is the difference. Functionality wise, yeah, there are some other differences as well. In terms of voting rights, in terms of treatment as a capital versus a loan, there are differences, but I don't want to get into that. Digraj, aisa normal kuch bhi nahi hota yaar. Har ek alag alag jo government ka department hai, they decide the own bond rates. Typically 8-9% rehte hain. They are pretty close to other government instruments. For example, a public provident fund or a post office saving deposit, it will be pretty much in that range. There are auctions also, so interbank also bonds can be bought and sold. There is no allotment, Shubham, of bonds. Bonds can be bought and sold by banks as per their choice. Okay, theek hai guys. So then let's move on to selective credit control. Now SCC is another instrument which the RBI has to control money supply. Again, in this they will not increase or decrease interest rates. What will happen in this is the RBI will give a mandate to banks, okay, that they can only put certain amount of money into one sector. For example, RBI can say, Mr. XYZ Bank, it will say to all banks that you cannot lend more than 500 crore rupees to the real estate companies. Or it can also say you have to lend minimum of 1000 crore rupees to the small scale industries. Right? So it will put quantitative restrictions. So it will selectively say who to give loans to and who not. Okay? It can also put qualitative restrictions. It can put qualitative restrictions in terms of documentation. It can reduce or increase documentation. It can reduce or decrease audit requirements. So whenever these restrictions are put on lending, qualitatively or quantitatively, these are called SCCs, selective credit control. Okay? No, it is done by RBI for the entire sector. It will not. So if it becomes bank specific, Shubham, it will become a punitive action. Okay, Mr. ICICI, aap nahi ye kar sakte, baaki sab kar sakte. That means ICICI is getting punished. That can happen if there is an infringement, if there is some policy violation by ICICI. That can happen in that case. But SCC nahi hai wo. SCC means RBI will say for the banking sector in general, each bank has to lend minimum 1000 crores to the small scale industry or for agriculture development, right? So it will be a banking sector mandate. Yeah, so even farmers, yes. So generally it is done for small scale industry, it is done for housing loans, it is done for agricultural development, right? It is done for these purposes. So you are basically controlling the supply of credit to different sectors differently. This is what RBI does in SCC. Okay. We are left with two. One is the marginal standing facility, MSF, and the other similar to this is LAF, Liquidity Adjustment Facility. Now, what are these two? Prabhat, then there is punitive action, yeah? There is a penalty action, there is a punitive action. Anuj, there are two reasons, yeah? One, your quality and cost of deposits bank to bank is different. And secondly, your quality and cost which you receive on your loans is also different for each bank. The fee and commission income for each bank is different, and that is why there is a huge difference in the performance bank to bank. For example, as a general thing, I can tell you that public sector banks have a much bigger exposure to the corporate sector in India. Private sector banks do more of individual banking. So that portfolio management kind of thing I was saying, not many public sectors bank do it. Private sector banks generally karte ho. So individual banking, wealth banking for rich people generally done by the private sector banks and foreign banks. Public sector banks do a lot of corporate banking, dealing with companies. So isliye har ek ka cost of funds different hai, loans pe revenue different hai, fee commission income different hai, isliye performance different hai. Yeah, so the LAF is the Liquidity Adjustment Facility. Okay. The Liquidity Adjustment Facility and the MSF are both rates at which the RBI lends money to the banks. Okay, these are both rates at which the RBI lends money to the banks. This is generally very short-term loans, right? So MSF and LAF are very, very short-term. They are generally overnight money or maximum for 2-3 days. These are for meeting banks' emergency requirements, emergency liquidity requirements, so that they don't deviate from the SLR requirements, or if there is any big income or payment coming up for a bank, right? So that is what the MSF and LAF are for. The difference between these two, one, in terms of, they are different in three ways. One, they are different in terms of the amount. So there is a cap which the RBI can lend to each bank. For all banks it is the same under LAF. After that it goes to MSF. Okay, LAF is a lower rate and MSF is a slightly higher rate. Okay, both of them have collateral requirements. Both of them, the banks have to keep collateral with the RBI. Okay, there is also difference in terms of the risk profile. So MSF for a bank, for the RBI, is more risky because it is over and above the LAF also. So if the bank has borrowed really a lot of money from RBI, and even though it is with a collateral, but there is the highest risk involved, even though banks really don't as a default nahi hota. MSF, the limit is much higher, yeah. It's close to, I think, 5000 crores, whereas under LAF it is 2000 crores. Yes, Shubham, the RBI's MSF rate is higher. It is close to 10% or 9.5% now, right? So this is all the tools which RBI can use to control the flow of money. As you can see, some are interest rate tools, some of them are flow tools. So in the sense, you can control the flow of money, so like under selective credit control, and open market operations, you can control how much money and how much government bonds are with the banking sector. Right, so the government, so the RBI can control the flow of money with all of these tools. Okay, I also wanted to discuss some current issues in banking. One, like I told you, was the movement to the MCLR, the marginal cost based lending rate, that the RBI has said will come into force from 1st April 2016. Other than that, in the last year or so, the banking sector in India has, so marginal cost of money, essentially, banks, the RBI is saying that banks should pass on the benefit of the decrease in repo rate to the borrowers. So in that sense, yes, they are trying to control the flow of money. So in that sense, yes, even the marginal cost of lending rate based lending is a monetary tool. It's a monetary policy tool, right? So in the last 1 year, I was saying, you have seen the banking sector slip. The banking sector in India in general has been facing a lot of NPAs. The ratio of NPAs of all the scheduled commercial banks has increased in the last 1 year. The CRAR. Now, what is CRAR? CRAR is basically the capital to risk weighted asset ratio. Okay, let me just put it down for you. So, capital to risk weighted assets ratio. Let me just give you a little bit of background on this. So, when a bank lends money, right, guys, you have something called as Basel norms. Okay, Basel norms. And currently we are working with Basel 2, but we are moving towards Basel 3. Towards enforcement of Basel 3. I'll come back to your question, Shubham. If you don't understand after the discussion, then you let me know. So Basel norms basically says that banks have to have a capital adequacy ratio, something called as CAR. Now, what is this CAR? Okay. So let us say a bank has a certain capital, which is again, capital is the money which the owners of the bank put into the bank, right? And of course, the bank gives loans. Like I said, personal loan diya, housing loan diya, credit card diya, corporates ko cash credit limit diya, bill discounting kiya, right? Corporates ko loans diye. It gives all these sorts of loans, right? Capital to assets or capital adequacy ratio means that Basel norms say that capital adequacy ratio, let's just assume a number should be, let us say 8%. What it means is that of all these loans given, your capital should be at least 8% of that. So if you give 1,000 rupees worth of loans, you must have at least 80 rupees worth of capital. So banks, if they want to lend more, the owners should bring in more money. So it can't be that you fund this entire 1000 rupees from borrowing. You can't just keep on borrowing from people and lending. You have to have minimum 8% of your loans as your owner's capital, right? So this is not the actual ratio of the capital adequacy ratio now, but this is just to give you an example to understand CAR. Okay. Anuj, again, got it? Okay, wonderful. Owner's capital is the owner. So for example, you guys are opening a restaurant. Okay. Some money you'll put in. Other than that, you'll borrow from the bank. So the money that you put in as the owner into the business is called a capital. Okay. It is the money the owner puts into his business from the owner. So bank ka owner koi to hoga, guys. So Citibank will have certain owners, certain people who own the share capital in Citibank. Similarly, State Bank of India has large ownership of the government of India. Okay, so there is somebody owning a bank. A bank is a company. There is a set of owners, every bank, right? So the owners have to bring in capital. That is the owner's funds. Yeah, Rana Kapoor is a large percentage owner in Yes Bank, right? So that's what the CAR basically says. The CAR says, the capital adequacy ratio says that there is a minimum requirement, a minimum percentage of loans which has to be maintained as capital. Okay. Otherwise, what can happen, which has happened in the US in the case of Lehman in 2008, you keep on borrowing money, you keep on giving loans, right? So you borrowed money and you lent money. When these guys defaulted, I put my hands up. I can't do anything because paisa to in logon ka tha and I lose nothing. I put in only 1 or 2 rupees. The rest is all people suffer. This has happened in the American banking sector. That is why in Basel 3, we are now moving towards Basel 3. The capital adequacy ratio has been strengthened, has been increased. Okay. So depending on the nature of the banks, we are looking at 12 to 14% CAR. 12 to 14% today, right? Okay, so what is now CRAR? Okay. This is very interesting, guys. Please have a look. So again, there is capital, owner's money, and then you give loans. I give personal loan, I give a housing loan, I give a credit card, I give a company a loan against a security, right? So let's say I give these four loans. I give 200 rupees to personal loan, housing loan I give 300 rupees, credit card I give 100, right? So that's 6, and company loans I give 400, right? So this is the first bank. Guys, can you hold your question for 5 minutes? Once I finish this, please ask me your questions together. Nahi to phir it gets lost in the chat box. Just hold your questions. Please ask me them once I ask you for questions. Right? So just give me 2 minutes. So this is the loan profile of, let us say, the first bank. CRAR, like I said, is capital to risk weighted assets. Yeah. Capital to risk weighted assets ratio. Okay. Now, what is a risk weighted asset? It basically means, right, all loans are not the same. Basel 3 says, boss, how can you say a personal loan and a home loan are the same? Personal loan you give to people without any security. Home loan, there is a house. Right? So therefore, the nature of these two is very different. Therefore, the risk of these two is very different. So Basel 3 says that we must classify loans into high, low and medium risk. And depending on the risk of each loan, their capital requirements will be different. So a high risk loan will require the maximum capital for the owners. A low risk loan will require the minimum capital from the owners. In other words, let us say the ratio is 3:2:1. Right? So just give me a minute, I'll explain. What it means is the highest loan, highest risk loans, I will treat at 3 times. The medium risk loan, I will treat as 2 times. The low risk loan, I will treat as 1 time. So again, let us go back to this example. So this is a company loan. I am saying this is very safe. I have the company's factory and their machines with me as security. So I will give it a rating of 1. Safest loan. Housing loan, not very safe. Housing prices can go up and down. So not very safe. I will say it's a medium risk loan. I will give it a risk rating of 2. Personal loan and credit card, no risk, no security. So therefore, very risky. Give it a rating of 3. So I will treat this 200 rupees as 200 into 3. This 300 rupees as 300 into the risk rating, which is 2. So 600. Credit cards, 100 into 3, 300. And loan, 400 into 1. It will stay at 400. Now I will look at my assets. 600 plus 600, 1200, 15 and 14, 419. I will require 12% of this amount as capital. I will not require 12% of 1000 rupees. Actual loan is just 1000 rupees. I will require for the bank in Basel 3, bank has to have 12% of 1900, which means the more risky a loan a bank gives, the more capital it has to keep. Aap agar sare corporate loans denge security rakke, aapko sirf 1000 rupees ka 12% capital rakhna padega. Aap personal loan, credit card zyada denge, aapka capital requirement bhi badh jayega. Now tell me, guys, have you understood? I can see a lot of people leaving the session. Very tough. Chalo, great. Prabhat, bataiye, what's the problem? Prabhat, I'm waiting for your question. Achha, chalo, ho gaya. Chalo, very good. So CRAR means capital to risk weighted assets. Maine in sab pe risk ka weight laga diya. All these assets, these are bank ke liye. Giving a loan is an asset for a bank. So I have put a risk weight to each asset and the capital requirement is in ratio of the risk weighted assets. So CRAR, now let us go back to that slide. Now have a look at it again. Now understand it in the context. CRAR of scheduled commercial banks registered some improvement. So the capital of some of the scheduled commercial banks, all the banks in India overall improved a little bit. They had a little more capital in this half year. That is from July till December. However, public sector banks, I told you, public sector banks have largely lent to corporates. Corporates are defaulting right now. So their risk is higher, have the lowest CRAR. They have the lowest capital to the risk profile of their loans. Public sector banks currently are the worst performers in the Indian economy. Okay, so I hope this slide is clear now, guys. Okay, so the current status of NPAs. So GNPA is a gross NPA, right? Yeah, Shubham, PSBs have given. So essentially what has happened, Shubham, like I said, PSBs have lent to corporates. So in theory, that should not be risky, because when you lend to a company, you are giving a loan backed by collateral, backed by security. So Shubham, you're right with that question that this doesn't sound right. But essentially what has happened is, look at Kingfisher. SBI saab ne 1000 crore de diya, UCO bank ne 5000 crore de diya, Punjab National Bank ne aur 5000 crore de diya. There have been multiple banks lending to the same borrower against a same security, against equal sharing of the same collateral. That is where the public sector banks have taken a wrong step. Essentially, lending to the corporate sector is in essence a safe thing. But public sector banks have overlent to the corporate sector. Look at what is happening with Kingfisher, na? And there are many such stories. Yeah, same collateral. Same collateral. RBI bhi yahi bolta hai. Anuj ji, RBI bhi yahi bolta hai. No, it's not fraud, yeah. It is your valuation. See, you're a bank. Giving a loan, I can give a loan to a beggar walking on a street. It is I who have to take it back. No, RBI kya bolta hai? RBI says, I consider this a risky loan. Have the capital to back it. Have your CRAR in place. You can lend to anybody, na? How is it fraud, right? So you can read from this slide that the highest level of stressed assets or stressed loans is in the public sector banks. Okay? So that is a little bit about the banking sector, guys. Today we have not been able to cover the entire session, but I think the most important parts, which is the monetary policy of RBI and the current status of the banking sector in India, is covered. We are left with the cooperative banks and the developmental banks. That part I will cover in another session. But any question on the discussion so far? Vipul, yeah, ye baat sach hai aapki, but look at it this way, yeah. Look at what is happening in Kingfisher today. Employees are not getting salaries, banks are not getting their loans back. But Vijay Mallya goes to Tirupati and gives a 5 kg gold chain as donation, right? So the world is full of ironies. The world is full of these things. But the banks have taken this risk and they have fallen on their face. The banks are doing that. But like I said, see, collateral is of, let's say, 100 rupees. Loans, sab logo ne diye hue, uske against 2000 rupay ke. To 100 rupees ko to kya bantoge, sabke muh mein ek dana hi aayega. So it is, they are, you know, encashing the collateral. That's fine, but it's not going to be enough. So Saket, you couldn't give loans at less than base rate, but now with the RBI's proposal, and which is going to come into effect from 1st April this year, you will be able to give short-term loans and floating loans at rates lower than base rate also. That is the vision of RBI. Oh, wonderful. Divya, you can get these. Sure, you can. You will have to call Bullseye, because I am not authorized to directly mail you, but you can call the office at Bullseye and I'm sure they will share these slides with you. Otherwise, you can check the HIT Bullseye website also. I'm sure these slides will be available somewhere on that website also. Otherwise, you can check out this particular session will also be uploaded onto YouTube by tomorrow or day after, and you can find the same slides there as well. Anuj, no, FDs don't have floating rates, yeah. So Amit, so directly RBI can't change the base rate. It is a tool for the banks. Banks have to decide their own base rate. But if RBI increases the cost of funds, so indirectly base rate ko to influence kari rahe na. So indirectly there is an influence on each bank's base rate. If the RBI increases the cost of repo rate, obviously bank's cost of funds goes up, they'll have to increase their base rate, right? Yes, Amit, RBI is the only lawmaker as well as controller, regulator of monetary policy in India, right? So thank you, guys. Then we'll close the session with that. I'll see you soon. Hope you understood some part of it at least. Yeah, it was a tough session. Hope you got a little bit out of it, right? Yeah, Digraj, what's the question? Digraj, it's not that it doesn't work, yeah. But you can understand that they have divergent objectives. See, the objective of the government of India is to increase the pace of growth of the economy, right? For that, the government would want the economy to have the lowest interest rates possible. Because when people have a lot of money, corporates have a lot of money, they'll spend more money into developing factories, into developing products. And of course, people will also have more money, they'll buy more products, the GDP will go up, the economy will grow faster. That's the government's objective. The RBI's objective is money control. So RBI has to look at inflation also. If too much money is there in the economy, inflation will go up, right? And therefore, the RBI has to do a balancing act. And sometimes there is a friction. Government's only objective is growth. RBI's objective is money supply control. It has to be optimum, neither too high, neither too low. Okay, guys? So I'll close it with that. Thank you.